I'm Georgia Groome, and I'm performing Clickbait by Millie Thomas at Theatre 503. Clickbait's the story of a teenage girl called Nicola, who goes on holiday and is filmed in a nightclub performing sexual acts. She comes home to England, and the video, she's being blackmailed with the video. They're saying they're going to leak it unless she provides money, and it's the story of her turning that exploitation into a good thing for her. So she posts the video herself, and then it unwinds from there. So I play Nicola, who is the girl who's being blackmailed with the sex tape, and it's a really interesting journey she makes. It's not necessarily obvious, or all the choices I would have made. But she finds kind of empowerment through her actions, and then goes on a very rocky road to the end of the play. But it's just a really different part. It's hard. She's quite boisterous and hardline, and I'm really not. So I really was looking forward to the challenge of playing her. Miley Cyrus has been a really big inspiration, kind of the new Miley, as opposed to her Hannah Montana days of innocence, and just her kind of using her sexuality and essentially exploiting herself in a really positive way has caused such a stir that it was really helpful. We watched a lot of her videos and a lot of her quotes. I think she said something like, you can try and hack my computer and find naked photos, I'm just going to post them myself. Like, go for it, I'll just post them. Which she said kind of mid-rehearsals, and that was really exciting for everyone because it kind of based what we were doing in a really strong way. Millie Thomas has written the play, and she's fantastic. She has a really strong voice that comes through in her writing. It's very snappy, and she really kind of knows the issues and has had fun with the issues in creating the play. And then directing is Holly Race Rolden, who's just brilliant as well. And they're kind of a great team. And it's been really fun to work with so many women. We have one male cast member, and we had a male assistant director. And it was nice to have a male presence, but you never get to work on like such a female-heavy team in theatre or film. So that was really exciting. And they were kind of a dream collaboration, I guess, which has been good. Nicola has two sisters, an older sister called Gina, and a younger sister called Chloe, and how they deal with the kind of video being released and onwards is very different. Kind of Gina's character is quite uptight, and she feels the worry and the fear and the social consequences before being pulled along for the ride. And whereas Chloe is a bit younger and is really kind of social media savvy, so it's her that really fuels the play forwards in terms of getting the video out and kind of trending. And then we have my boyfriend, who struggles the whole way through with kind of understanding Nicola's choices, I think, as you probably would. And I think we drew inspiration for him from, there's a documentary called Hot Girls Wanted on Netflix, which explores webcamming and kind of the young girls. I think it's in Miami or Vegas. And there's a boyfriend in that whose girlfriend is webcamming, and he just finds it extraordinarily difficult, but is still with her. And then we have the bloggers make up the kind of majority of the play, really. They're the outside voice. They're played by the rest of the cast in fox masks, bear masks. And they're kind of giving the tweets and the comments that would be made by keyboard warriors on the internet. And then we have Kat, who is a client of the business we set up. And I can't say much more about her because it's spoilers. Our production designer, Frankie, has created this kind of mad world. Everything's white, a bit like, it's a bit of an iPhone. The set looks like an iPhone. And the sound design and the lights as well kind of bring that world to life. It's all kind of like the swipes of your finger on the iPhone and the noises tweets make the whole way through, kind of the laptop and the phone and things like that have a really kind of strong role within the play, because it's all to do with online and that thing of once it's out there, you can't take it back, which is so topical right now. And so everything's kind of crispy and white with splashes of colour. And that's kind of the world that's been created. Something most of us struggled with in rehearsals was the kind of not judging people. It's really hard. Like, I could have sat down for hours and judged Nicola for the decision she made. So I think it was really interesting having to kind of re-educate my own thoughts and redetermine what I thought. And it has changed. Like, I think it is empowering. And as my reaction to porn before would definitely kind of been, it's for teenage boys or dirty old men. It's just not something I knew a huge amount about. And I've seen it, and I think there's a really sad, dark side to it, especially for women. And I think that's because it is a really masculine, kind of patriarchal business where women are being exploited. But I think that's kind of what Millie's getting at, is that, you know, women, there's a line in the play of women are sexual creatures, not sexual objects, I think is the point. And I think that's what the play is kind of exploring and looking at, and the thing of, you know, the videos that kind of, they're on the Mirror and the Daily Mail online, the kind of videos of the girls in Magaluf or Zante or wherever that have performed, which the play is based on, kind of performing sexual acts in nightclubs, and they're the ones whose face is in the paper, whose name is named, and they've got the press around at the house, but you go, what about all the boys that were there and having that done to them? Why is the woman a slut and they're kind of like lads having a good time? It's a really unfair, unbalanced way of looking at sex. Takes two to tango. The line between exploitation and empowerment is very fine, and I don't think it's not clear-cut in any way. And I think even for the play, you leave asking more questions than are answered. So although for the majority of the play we see Nicola being empowered, the play then flashes forward and you see the kind of where it's come from, which definitely isn't empowerment. It is exploitation. And it's about whether or not you're able to turn it, I think. But I think it all comes down to the word consent, which we've talked a lot about in rehearsals, and is again so topical with the kind of the universities now. I think all of America have to do it, and most of the kind of UK universities have started doing it, where you have to go to consent lectures and people are going, but I'm not a rapist, I don't need to go to a consent lecture. But actually people don't understand the meaning of the word, and it's where the play kind of gets quite scary and murky, is all around that word. And I think it's really important. Like, I'd want my little sister to know about that, because it is, yeah. There's so many problems still. The hacking of the actors' phones, as you were saying, was horrible. There was, like, I had friends that were hacked. And again, it was mainly the women that got the coverage. There was loads of men whose photos were stolen, but nobody cared, because they were men. The women were more interesting. And it's that imbalance that's scary. And the kind of the websites where you post, the revenge porn website, like, that guy's only just gone to prison. But it's really scary that those websites exist and that people, I suppose that's the word, clickbait, and it shouldn't be clickbait, because it's people's lives. And like, the cloud is a really scary thing of, once it's out there, it's never really gone. And I think it's something people need to think about, but it's also, I guess it's a bit sad you have to think about it, because, like, it shouldn't be something to be ashamed of, but the stigma is there for it to be something to be ashamed of. And it's about changing that. And I think that's what Millie's exploring with the play, is kind of, it's just the line of what people think is acceptable. And that's what's so fun about the play, is kind of seeing, especially with the younger audiences, who really get it and they really understand the kind of social media and all of this stuff that's been going on. It really speaks to them. And I think seeing their reaction of what's so far over the line that they suddenly go silent, but what they also think is hilarious and okay and cool, is really interesting, kind of where the ball falls. And then seeing older people who, you know, I don't know whether they, I guess it's, that's not there. When they would have been sending those photos, the opportunity, the access to do it wasn't there. There wasn't the internet and things. So they just kind of look at it in a, what? Like, stupid young people. And that's not the thing. It's just how we're living at the moment. So, yeah. I think what's interesting with the play is from the outset, she decides not to be the victim. There's maybe a split second at the top of the play where you see a bit of vulnerability, and then she goes straight in for kind of empowerment, and I'm not going to be a victim. But surrounding this are the tweets and the kind of voices, if we call them the bloggers, which are essentially the keyboard warriors of this world. And you only have to look on, like, I find the Daily Mail comment section, like, such a terrifying place, where you read the stuff and you're like, why, who are you to say that? And why are you commenting on that? Like, you're a 50-year-old man, or, you know, a 12-year-old girl. Like, be quiet. And but that equally is a world, and the kind of, what's the word? I guess kind of the internet age of anything you put out there now, that's fact. There's nothing we can really do about that. That's fact. Anybody can comment on anything. Everybody's kind of a reporter or a witness to some extent because of it. And that's really scary. But equally, with kind of photos and explicit things, like, you know, I wouldn't send one, definitely, because, like, I've seen, you see what happens and it's lessons learned, but people do, and you trust people, and that trust gets broken and the photos end up where they end up. And it's just, it's, I think it's scary. There's not really anything that can be done about it. It's a really hard kind of thing to navigate when you're in that situation. From what we've been looking at in rehearsals, the research we did, kind of, there's not a huge amount the police can do. And it's up to each website if they take it down or not. And that's really scary. But that's the iPhone generation, I think. We read a lot of kind of articles about feminism and empowerment to do with female sex. And that's all really great. It's really interesting. And I read a lot of Country Life on Facebook, which is kind of the Oxford site that was set up for feminism. And it's really interesting. There's so many layers, like, you just don't even know about, and it changes every day, the definitions. And then the more shocking side was I watched the Magaluf video, which you feel really horrible and dirty doing, like, whenever those sex tapes were released and things like that. I'd never watch them because I think it's such an invasion of those people's lives. And if you watch them, you're essentially letting it happen and encouraging it to happen. But I did watch the Magaluf girl, and it's heartbreaking. Like, she's having fun, good for her, like, she was having a nice time. But she was, the comments and things that came underneath the video, that's still, like, the first search item when you put it Magaluf girl into Google, still the first thing that comes up. She's not very old. And it was just really traumatizing to know that, like, that's still out there. She can never properly move away from that, because that's always going to be in the bowels of the internet. And she's the name. There's at least 20 guys stood around her. And it was just a real eye-opener that kind of pushed, I think, for everybody doing the play, kind of Nicola's story and the world forwards. And then I watched some pretty gross porn that just made me feel a bit sad again, where everyone just looks a bit too young and are being used as objects. It's, I don't know. I find porn extremely difficult to quantify or understand. And equally, I do. And kind of the webcamming as well. I watched a webcam session and it just left me feeling quite sad. I think it's important for women to do whatever we think we need to do. And I'm fully behind all of that, the kind of free the nipple thing and the slut-shaming marches. Like, yeah, if we don't put the message out there, it's kind of ignored. And those publications that continue to run, like Page Three and stuff like that, are going to continue. And I think just in terms of, like, women not being sexual objects, I think is really important, and I think it will stop, you know, a lot of bad things that happen to women from happening if we take that stigma away. So, yeah. And I see what you're saying where it exacerbates. But I think that's it's kind of void because it's more important to do what we have to do. And if those women feel empowered by that and the women that have been kind of attacked and things, then even better. There's a woman, I can't remember her name. She's an amazing lady who was, she works in, she's a blogger and she has an Instagram site and a blog, and she was raped and set up a blog to kind of claim back the power. And then she was on a tour of, I think, South Africa and kind of giving messages of, you know, claiming back your power after you've been raped, and like anti-rape messages and trying to raise awareness in areas that don't have much awareness. And she was raped again, and she live tweeted the whole thing as soon as it happened. And it's that kind of bravery is where the internet really comes into its own. That hit a lot of people, and a lot of people took kind of solace in that. And there's still the people, there's still the voices that are going, well, why did you go to the shower? Why did you do this? And questioning her. But at the end of the day, she had the power. She wasn't scared. And I think that's also one of the messages of the play that's really important. I think with the theatre, it scares me more than anything. That's why I like performing. And I think it's good to try and do one every now and again. Just because it keeps you on your toes and it's a different thing. But B, there's nothing like being in the audience at the theatre. And in a film, every film or TV, everything's kind of clear-cut and perfect. Whereas you never know. I had a nosebleed on stage the other day. I had a really bad cold and my nose bled throughout a whole like 7 minute scene. And you could just feel the audience not knowing how to react and saying, was that real? Or is that like a blood bag? Like, was it not meant to happen? And that's really exciting. And I think it's right there. It draws you in. And you don't always get that in a film. A film can feel quite far away. Whereas in a theatre, you're pulled into a mad world for, you know, an hour, 2 hours. And then you're thrust back out onto the street to think about it. And I think that's really cool. I think what we all hoped would happen has happened. And that's that people go out talking about the issues. I had a load of my closest friends in last night who all kind of came out being like, but what would you do? And like, how would you react if that was your sister? Da, 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 da. But also the wider kind of topics of consent and the empowerment and claiming back our sexuality and things like that. I think a lot of plays tie things up into a neat bow of that's what I think. And I think you don't get that with Clickbait. I think it leaves, there's not a clear viewpoint. It kind of touches on everything, which is so brilliant. It lets the audience think for themselves rather than telling the audience that, you know, porn is good or porn is bad and, you know, women are sexual creatures, women aren't. You can leave and make your own mind up, but equally kind of, I think it makes you look at your kind of morals in quite a clear way. And that's really exciting. I think it's exciting to leave the theatre. I like to leave the theatre and think and kind of go away, buzzing off the plane, thinking about it. And that's what the audience seems to have been doing, especially the young people. Like, they've really got it and have taken a lot away from it, as far as we know.